Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
We're going to get started here. So if you're just coming in, please find your seats. So my name is MIchele Titolo, and the only way I'm going to introduce myself today is saying that if you had asked me in high school or college what I was going to do with my life, I would have told you that I would be living in New York, working on some sort of show, backstage, every day, day in, day out. So today, I'm here to talk about theater. Why am I here to talk about theater? Well, one of the reasons that I personally got into theater was I really liked building things. And in my high school, the only way you could do that with power tools and, you know, the end of it creating something actually useful and not just like another rabbit piggy bank was to do theater. And when it comes down to it, when I think of theater, I think of the intersection between technology and storytelling. Now, human culture has had a fantastic oral tradition that goes back millennia, but it wasn't until people started applying technology to storytelling that we get something that is as amazing and immersive and popular as it is. So when it comes down to it, theater is about creating immersive experiences. They want you to get caught up in it. They want you to be sitting there so enraptured with what you're seeing, you've literally blocked out everything else that is on your mind. But there's more to it than that, because it's very rare that a show happens only once. If you look at Broadway, for instance, there are some shows that run for over 10 years. And that means that every single night, everything has to be perfect. You need execution, and you need it now, you need it fast, and you need to do it in a way that it can be reproduced over and over and over and over again, because otherwise people will get upset, your show will close, and you won't make any money. So the way that theater does this is by creating really, really fantastic processes. And they practice them over and over and over again to get them right. But something that's come out of the 2 centuries or so of Western theater is that technology, the technology available, the technology that's used, influences what actually goes on in the show. So today, I'm going to walk you through the evolution of that. And we're going to start way back in ancient Greece. I'm talking 4th century BC. This is where the first theaters, physical theaters that we have record of were built. Yes, this is old. Let's look at a little bit of the technology that was available at that time. So there are these things called periactoi. There's going to be some Greek words. I hope I pronounce them correctly. This is one of the earliest forms of scenery that playwrights and actors and the entire theater industry had access to. They were really, really simple. They were just 3-sided columns that had different scenes painted on each side. And what would happen over the course of the show was they'd get turned to indicate different parts of the show, different places that the actors could be in. Now, this is important because this was about as much hint the audience got as to where different scenes were taking place. When you think about going to a Broadway show these days, there's elaborate scenery and blackouts, and in 30 seconds, what you're seeing on stage can magically change. Not quite back in ancient Greece. So playwrights were limited to 3 different scenic backdrops. This influenced both the plays that were written and obviously how the plays were performed, because someone had to take care of all the The next piece of technology was called the God Machine, otherwise known as Mekene. To you and me, it's just a simple crane that lifts someone up. And the reason that this is important is because in almost every single Greek play, it ends with something called Deus Ex Machina, which is where a god comes in and essentially solves everyone's problem and saves the day. Basically, they really, really like their gods. So before the invention of this, there was a physical platform built in the theater that the actor had to go up, climb up to, and then, all of a sudden pop out. but that wasn't really surprising because it was always in the same spot. A lot of times you could see when the actor was climbing the stairs, so as an audience member, you were able to kind of see that the show was ending soon, so it wasn't really the greatest experience. So they invented this crane machine. This was the most complex technology that the Greeks used in theater, but it was only used once per show. All of this work to honor their gods. Welcome to Greek culture. Next was this thing called the eklekema. Another fun Greek word, lots of case in there. Sometimes it has Z's in it. But all this really is a rolling platform. This is one of the few things that you'll see in mass-produced theater today, where you have a platform, you set up a scene on it, roll it on stage, roll it off stage. And just a quick little diagram, there are lots of other things too, but these are the three that I'm mainly going to talk about because they have the greatest effect on how shows were put together. So in this one you can see there's the mechaneing, there's the eklekema, you know, everyone's kind of happy with that. Even with this limited set of technology, when you think of what we have today, this is like, oh, that's not much. They had some wheels, they had something that turned, a crane, it's not that bad. They actually had a lot of challenges that they had to deal with when reproducing these shows all the time. First of all, these were outdoor theaters. So everything was in the view of the audience. Everything depended on the sun. So, you know, the blockouts that we're used to today, sitting in theaters, did not happen. Scene changes were all out in the open. So there goes your surprise. And everything, except for a few little bits and pieces, was made out of stone. Unlike a lot of the really cool modifications you can do today that they did later, people were seeing pretty much the exact same backdrop to everything. And as I mentioned, it was really, really hard to surprise people. Not that Greek theater did that a ton, but they did want it. They did want people to not be able to tell when the end of the show was coming because they wanted to teach whatever lesson the show was leading to. Now, actually running a show. Playwrights directed. If you know anything of modern theater, you know for a fact that the playwright is a very different role than the director. But back in ancient Greece, the people who wrote the show were pretty much always the ones making all the shots, calling all the shots. And everyone else shared responsibility. So if props needed to be moved, an actor did it. If, you know, someone needed to help with the god machine, an actor did it. Someone needed to turn a periactoid, an actor did it. And this was really simple. But because the technology available was also incredibly simple, they didn't really need a whole lot of process around it. It was all pretty much, you're going off stage, hey, take this thing with you. In modern theater, I know a lot of actors would scoff if they had to, you know, make a set piece. That's just because of the way I feel. So, the next time period I'm going to talk about is the 16th century, specifically within the greater context of the Renaissance. And the reason it's such a big time jump is after the fall of the Roman Empire, all of the culture that was inherited, the Romans inherited from the Greeks and kind of improved upon, but not really, that was all lost. And it wasn't until the Renaissance of the 16th century that they started discovering these new things and applying them back into the art form. And this is really where theater, as we know it today, really started, even though it does harken back to its roots. So, technology. The Renaissance was really, really big on perspective. It changed the way that architects worked, it changed the way that artists work. It basically changed everything, including theater. This is the Palladio Theater in Venice. And you can see, this is a theater, so as it goes back, it looks like it's really far back. Gives you that sense of depth, that sense of realism, that what's happening on stage is actually happening. This is a cross-section of that theater, and you can see how they use perspective to actually take the back of the stage and angle it upwards. And that's how they achieve the perspective effect. But again, just like the ancient Greeks, this was a static background. They actually built that entire backdrop, that entire town in theater. So if you want to go suddenly into a forest, that's not going to plays were performed and how they were run. And no scene changes. At first, I guess there's a little bit more, but when a theater is like built like this, they couldn't do scene changes. So it meant a lot of the experience was up to the audience's imagination, which is sometimes great, but the Renaissance was all about realism and making things seem like they were actually happening on stage and not just, you know, in your mind. The next bit of technology was called the chariot and pole. This was the first time that large, heavy pieces of scenery were allowed to be moved. And what happened was there's basically an entire layer underneath the stage with giant pulleys and ropes that would move different pieces of scenery back and forth. Scenery still couldn't be changed, so if you had a tree on one pole, it would always be a tree. For as long as the show ran, they actually took down the tree and put on another thing. They didn't quite get the interchangeability that we expect to have. But it was great, because then you could go from a town to a forest in a relatively short period of time. And there are like some of the really cool pulley modifications. This is actually a theater in the Ukraine that had all of these things, and just giant levers and winches that would move these really, really heavy theaters, because everything was made out of wood. And obviously vocal wood, because you want to do it as cheap as possible, because margins on theaters are always really slim. So you want to do it as cheap and as fast as possible. So this became built into some theaters. But for other theaters that didn't necessarily want to go dig underneath the stage and all of these complicated things, the next evolution that came is wing and drop. This is something that if you've been to a show in the past 10 years, you've definitely seen. It's really popular with community theater or high school theater, any local theater groups that don't necessarily have a big budget to go through and actually build real trees. So all this was is painted panels. So you get some really fantastic artists, and they paint some canvas for you, and then they hang it. So if you look above the stage in this, you can see that there's a bunch of hanging scenery. And this allowed pieces to be moved out of sight and then back into sight relatively easily, allowing for much greater flexibility in the spaces. This is called fly system. And this is used in modern theater today. Anytime you see pretty much any modern theater, this is happening behind the scenes. There's things flying in and out. There's a ton of stuff above the stage. So those were the real big innovations in the 16th century. But they brought some really interesting challenges. The goal was to make experiences more immersive. They wanted people to feel like they were part of the show. They wanted people to feel like they were part of the story that was happening. So the biggest challenge was creating something very immersive. Because of all these new things happening with the Renaissance, playwrights decided to have a lot of fun with it. So they, instead of just having an entire play in one place, they'd have it in different places. They'd be able to have, you know, forest 1 minute, city the next. And it greatly changed the way that playwrights wrote scripts, because for the first time, you could give things like stage directions and text. Greeks had no stage directions, by the way. If you've never read a Greek play, it's just text. It doesn't say this person leaned over the table or anything you kind of expect in modern theater. But the biggest challenge by far was the weight of all of this new technology, physical weight, because with chariot and pole, you had things sliding on pulleys and had to move the entire system. And then things above the stage, obviously, you had to make sure they didn't come crashing down on the actor's head while they weren't performing, because that would be bad. So what happened when you actually came time to make a show? This is the first time that stagehand became a dedicated job. And not just like one or two, but there'd be teams of people, because this stuff was really heavy. So when you're moving it, you oftentimes needed significant force, which is why we got pack animals. No joke. There'd be donkeys or horses or something underneath the stage pulling those chariots along, because that was the most effective way to do it. So in addition to having all of your people now being part of your theater performance, you have, you know, to take care of horses and donkeys. Oh, by the way, how are the horses and donkeys getting under the stage? created a lot more chaos and required a lot more forethought and planning. So what happened was they introduced a new job. Only one, so I didn't stage hand, but a new job called a stage manager. This is someone who, during the performance, was responsible for making sure all of the scenery moved at the correct time, making sure everyone practiced the scene transitions, because you did have to practice. If you wanted like two trees to move at the same time, you actually had to practice that like one didn't start before the other. You needed to make sure that they were the same, which requires practice. And they were in charge of making sure every task had someone to work on it. Because if one tree moved and one tree didn't, that's not really gonna work. And these people were there, and still are there, this job is still around today. They're there every single night of the performance. It's not a one and done. It's you're there 2 hours before the show, you stay until everything's cleaned up and everyone's ready to go home. So it's kind of like a full-time job, except you don't start until like 5 o'clock at night. And they also fought any fires that would come up during showtime. Quite literally sometimes, because remember, this is the 16th century, they used candles. So sometimes things would actually catch on fire. So they also had lots of contingency in place. So, now the fun part. This is the 19th century to the present. Between the Renaissance and the late 1800s, really more than most of the 19th century, not much changed. There was some innovation, but we had all of these wars, and then more wars, and so the arts kind of suffered. So, some of this is probably going to seem similar to you, but we'll go through it. Lighting. As I just mentioned, candles were originally used in theaters. Now, set pieces were made of wood. Candles burn. There were some problems with that. And also, it was really difficult to change the lighting during performance because when either a candle is lit or a candle is not lit. And if it is not lit, someone needs to go and light it. So they didn't really do that. The lights were on all the time. And for the most part, the audience was also lit up. So it wasn't until the invention of gas lighting that got added to theaters were they really able to dim the lights in the audience and have the actors on stage be the only ones illuminated. But this was obviously also dangerous because gas is flammable. And there were a number of theater fires. So they decided we need to look into something better because this isn't really working for us. We don't want our theaters burning down. The first incandescent light bulbs were installed in a theater in London in 1861. And this entirely revolutionized theater, and would continually revolutionize theater as lighting technology got better. But this was the first time there was safe lighting. It could be separate between audience and stage, and they could actually position lights anywhere they wanted to. No longer was there only one light for the entire stage. It was either on or off. It was, oh, we can only light half the stage. Oh, we can put a spotlight on someone. All of these new ways of lighting people and new ways of doing production came about. So the real innovation here is the fact that lighting can be changed, which was really, really awesome. The next thing that came to theater was iron and steel. The arts industry always lags behind the rest of technology just because it needs to wait until technology gets to a lower price point so they don't have to spend tons and tons of money making it. And we all know that metal is awesome. So people were really excited about it. But what really did this mean? This meant that there were now even larger and heavier set pieces to move. Originally, when you're thinking of the iron that came around in steel in the late 1800s, that stuff was really heavy. We didn't have any of the really lightweight stuff that we use today. In fact, in those modern theaters, aluminum is the metal of choice because it is really strong, but also incredibly light. So they don't have to do a lot of extra work to move it around. The next big thing was motors. These didn't start showing up in theaters probably until the 70s, just because they were really expensive. Something needed to be able to move all of those heavy set pieces around. And even in a lot of older theaters, like high school theaters are a great example, they won't actually have motors. They'll still be moving things around using counterweights, which is really, really dangerous. And then finally, and the coolest thing is hydraulics. Has anyone here seen the show Cobb at go up and down and spin and turn. The hydraulics that they added to that were so big, they had to break the roof above the theater. And when they were done, they built hotel rooms around them, so from the outside, you couldn't see the two giant hydraulic towers. They go to a lot of lengths to get the theater to be really great, circus especially. So, things got really, really complicated, bringing me to electronics. Now, I could have done an entire talk on how the electronic age influenced theater and made things possible, because it changed everything, and then it changed everything again, and then it kept changing it. But I will give one specific example around computers, because we're all technologists. We want to know what happened with computers. So we had incandescent light bulbs, which at first you could turn on and off. Then they invented something called a dimmer switch, which does exactly what you think. You could turn it up to a certain intensity and back down. Then computers came along, and finally, we were able to, at a specific time, have all the lights dim at once by a push of a button. So this is, for a long time, the Broadway shows, like the big hits done by like Disney and all of the really good producers, they weren't actually allowed to use these new lighting boards that were computerized because there were unions of people who would do the dimmers up and down in the show. They had teams of people. Every show they had a script and certain line they would put a light up, they would put a light down. And it was about almost a decade before the unions worked it out with the theaters so that they could actually use these new computerized light boards, which were much better at coordinating three sets of lights coming up at once, let me tell you. So there were a lot of challenges brought on by this. The first was just being able to keep up with innovation. I remember when the first multimedia shows started happening and people wanted live video on stage, it was ridiculous because they were like, well, we have these cameras, we have these long cords, we can't bring the long cord with the camera on stage because that would look weird. And it was all sorts of crazy. And innovation just kept happening. It's not like before where there was like one round of innovation and that was it. It was innovation, 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 innovation. And each time, it became slightly easier to adapt that, so it became adapted quicker. So first you had gaslighting, and then you had incandescent lighting, and then you had dimmers, and then you had programmable light boards. And that all happened within the span of about 70 years, versus, you know, previously we had some perspective scenery that stayed pretty much the same until the 1800s. Safety also became a huge concern. Not only did you have panels of fabric hanging above your head, you had pieces of metal that weighed several hundred pounds. So, and eventually, they actually outlawed in a lot of states the use of open flame on stage, because fire is still a problem. All of those drapes that you see hanging in theaters, they all have a special fire retardant on them, because fire is still a concern on these things. Things still catch on fire, basically. But there are all sorts of new safety concerns, because all of these motors, all of these hydraulics, how do you make sure that performers are safe? Actors' Equity, which is the big union in New York for all of the actors who do most Broadway shows and most of the big off-Broadway shows, they get hazard pay when certain things happen. If the stage is angled at a specific degree, not only do they get hazard pay, they get a specialist to come in and teach them how to walk on it so that they won't hurt themselves. There are specific requirements around how much counterweight you need. Do you need to get specially trained to activate one of the motors that's used, et cetera, et cetera. So what this ended up becoming is a realm of increasingly specialized workers. You were trained in how to operate this motor, so no one else could operate this motor except for you. A little bit of a problem sometimes, because people still got sick, people still took vacation, people still had babies. So there are all sorts of reasons that you need to have not just one person that knows how to do this thing, but essentially understudies too, just like actors have understudies in case they get sick or break a leg, literally, or anything else. And what this led to was a new scale in theater productions. I mean, the 90s saw a great resurgence, especially in New York, on fantastic, technologically advanced shows. A lot of it funded by big companies because they had the money, but now we're still seeing littler theaters, especially if there's Seattle Rep, there's Berkeley Rep, there's Chicago, great theaters around the country being able to make use of these technological achievements. So a lot changed when it comes down to opening night, when it comes down to actually running a show. Instead of just having one team of people basically doing very similar jobs, that's just move this pulley at this time versus move this pulley at that time, instead you have very, very specialized teams and multiple different ones from multiple different areas. The bigger shows even have assistants on those teams. So it's pretty common in New York, if you have a stage manager, you'll have two assistant stage managers, because the one stage manager isn't capable of taking care of all of the responsibilities of that job. They learned really fast that if one person gets overworked, another point of failure, it's gonna be terrible. So they eliminated single points of failure by creating assistants. They also started being more organized in pre-production. So this is before the show opened, usually before rehearsals even started, because you need to do things like budget for the set, because someone needs to construct the set. Usually you need to rent lights, someone needs to rent lights and take inventory of what you already have. So each team had a lead. There'd be a lighting lead, technical lead, costuming lead, sound lead. They'd all get together. They'd have meetings. Yes, they had lots of meetings, weekly meetings, because guess what? Things change over the course of production. Oh, this one piece of scenery is way too expensive, so we can't use it. Everyone needs to know about that. The lighting needs to change, the place of the microphone and the computers might need to change. Basically, without coordination before a show starts getting in production, nothing's going to work. Because all of a sudden there's going to be a giant set piece in a way of like that one light that needed to hit that one person at that time. And no one's going to be happy with that. Also, a new invention was called Tech Week. Those of you who have theater friends refer to it as Tech Week. And actual theater, big productions will actually take several weeks. But what this is quality assurance. This is where they run through the shows beginning to end with all of the pieces in place, and they keep doing it over and over and over again until everything is right. Sometimes these go really late. So I remember I did an internship in New York City after my freshman year of college, and I remember being there until 12:30 one night when I had to take an hour and a half to go home afterwards. It's not great. But the best part about this is that you practice the coordination, because there are so many individual moving pieces and people, which are the worst part because you never know what a person's going to do. Everyone coordinated and everyone had to practice it. And only by practicing were they actually able to do it every single time. If you were at Daniel's talk yesterday, this is what we call the Monday habit. And then they invented these things called previews. So if you ever try to buy tickets to a show and you wonder why it's a preview ticket and it's cheaper, that's because they haven't worked out all the kinks yet. So chances are something's probably going to go wrong, whether it's a light turns on at the wrong time, speakers stops working, or anything else. And that's because increased complexity. Over the past 140 years, technology has advanced so much that it has more than, probably an n squared level of complexity from before in how it took to put these things together. So this is the thing. The process I just described with pre-production, stage managers, tech weeks, you can go to any theater in America, and this is how they do things. Every single one of them has seen that this works, and they might do different flavors of it. Sometimes you have two people doing kind of the same job for small productions, but they still have both titles, because people understand what the titles mean. People understand that division of responsibility, because it's been ingrained into your head by doing core productions when you're in college, or high school, or whatever. But what about software? Software engineers, developers, people in the tech industry, what can we learn about this, from this? Well, we all know technology evolves, and that it continually evolves faster than it did before. So you kind of need to keep up. You need to have it at the beginning and the end. And also, as we work on our projects, and we work on our own individual applications, they also evolve technologically. They get more advanced, they get bigger, they get more complex. And one thing that theater does really well is it adds this new technology to its existing processes, and it evolves those. It makes them better than they were before. It makes sure that we're using the best things that we could be using, but we're still able to execute every single time, and you know, the whiteboards are crashing because they do that these days because they're computers. And all of this is because execution matters. This is something we all know from software. If you write crappy software, no one will use it. It needs to be executed really well, and standards are really high. Because we really care about an experience. We want users to have great experiences using our products. We want them to come back. We want them to buy it. We want them to tell their friends about it. So we need to care about great experiences. So just like in theater, as our technology changes, we really need to learn embracing evolution and working with these innovations instead of fighting against them. Thanks.
It's all open source.
Define open source.